Well, welcome once again to Lillehammer on a brightening morning. I'm David Goldstrom, and alongside me, Mike Dixon, for the concluding part of the women's Lillehammer cross-country triple. They've raced the sprint in freestyle. They've raced the 5 kilometer in freestyle skate. And today, it's all about the 10-kilometer classic pursuit. As a result of the first two competitions, the pursuit race will be led off by Marit Bjørgen, who's going to have a 20-second advantage over Heidi Weng and 32 over Teresa Jutaug. But before we get to that, just a reminder of what we have ahead. And there is the morning program for you, all Central European times. And a really good mixture of Nordic and also, as you can see there, snowboard and freestyle skiing involved in our Sunday morning offer to all of you. Must be something there, surely, for all of you to enjoy. And the afternoon packed with a variety. The Women's Pursuit up in Östersund, Patrick Winterton will be hosting that for you. Nordic Combined, Gundersen, the concluding part of their second competition. That's over on Eurosport 2, live at 1:15. And then later in the day, we return to North America for the alpine skiing. That's in Beaver Creek and in Lake Louise. So plenty to look forward to. The women, though, are getting ready for their 10-kilometer classic. Norway, after the first two legs, occupying the first five places. Well, it's just after 10 o'clock in the morning at the Birkebeiner station, where they're getting ready for the decisive part of the women's cross country, 10 kilometers in classic style, in a pursuit form, catch me if you can. And it'll be Marit Bjørgen leading out to say to all of her challengers, all 90 of them, if you can surpass me, you'll be doing very well. Norway in a commanding position in the race, but before we concentrate on that, a little rewind to what happened yesterday. Teresa Jutaug really enjoying what is and what was for her a really demanding course, but she really enjoyed it with the uphills and the undulating terrain, really using her power to weight ratio to come home to take the lead, and then having to sit and wait for Marit Bjørgen. And Marit Bjørgen setting out on the first 900 meters with great purpose. And by the time she got up that climb, she had a 4-second cushion. Teresa Jutaug was watching, and by just 3 hundredths, the differential between these two.
Really good race today, and it's really fun to see that I also can go fast on the 5K. I'm in really good shape now, and it's also good to see that all the training I've done with the sprint has been good. So I'm looking forward to tomorrow. I think it will be a hard race, so I will do my best, and then we'll see.
Well, not for the first time this season, a clean sweep on the podium for the Norwegians. Well, we do have other action on Eurosport 2, and if you're minded to desert us for the cross country, we'd be awfully disappointed. But if snowboarding is what you really want to see, they've been in action over in Copper Mountain in North America, and highlights of the Copper Mountain halfpipe underway on Eurosport 2 at this very moment. But we're just 10 minutes away from the start of this cross-country race, so those of you who want to see live action here and the concluding part of the women's cross-country race, we'll be back with that after this. Thank you. Well, we're just about 5 or 6 minutes away from the start of the cross-country race that will determine the outcome of the Lillehammer Triple, as it's known. It's the combination of performances that began on Friday with the freestyle sprint won by Marit Bjørgen, and then the times and differentials created from that are brought forward to yesterday's individual time trial race over 10 kilometers freestyle, where Teresa Johaug just got the better of Marit Bjørgen. So today, having taken those two races into consideration, we now have a starting order for the pursuit. And it sees Marit Bjørgen as the woman who will start the race and say, catch me if you can, to Heidi Weng, her Norwegian teammate, to Teresa Johaug, also a Norwegian teammate, and for good measure, Ragnhild Haga, who had a terrific cross-country race yesterday in classic style, and also to Ingvild Ersberg. And after her, the first of the non-Norwegians, and that's Charlotte Kaller, for whom 10 kilometers in classic style is not as fearsome as it used to be. She is, of course, the Vancouver Olympic champion at 10 kilometers in freestyle. Well, these just some of the images that must be so familiar to many of you. Great Norwegian snow and great atmosphere, and a really nice place to be. Not so chilly this morning. It was just -1, the air temperature in the ski jumping stadium, but we've come up in altitude, so it will be a little chillier here. And this is the situation. This is the way they're going to start. So you can see the Norwegian domination there. Not just 4, but 6 in the top 10 and 7 in the first 11. So they're very strongly represented. But basically, this is all about a chase.
A great performance from you last weekend in the 10-kilometer classic. Are you excited for today?
Yes, this will be a really fun race today. I hope to do a great race and pick some places forward.
Yeah, I think you're just over 2 minutes back from the lead, and for sure there's athletes that you skied ahead of last week, so you should be able to move up the list quite a bit.
Yes, it's really tight between everyone, so I think it will be an exciting race.
Well, good luck to you today.
Thank you.
Yeah, Sofia's got a lot to do to run through an awful lot of traffic, but having said that, she is one of the really talented youngsters, just 20 years of age. And when you look at her junior world championship performances last year, skiathlon, she was 11th, but a 5-kilometer classic, which is perhaps more relevant for today, she was the silver medalist. So time for me to say a very good morning to Mike Dixon, sitting right alongside me as the Waxman do their final preparations for the early starters.
They are, David, and always tense moments to make sure that, in fact, with minutes to go, changing the wax or putting on the fluorocarbon waxes to maximize the glide. And it's a big team effort getting your athletes prepared for this. Very interesting start line, David, with we saw there the time deficits. Well, remember last weekend, Teresa Johaug won the 10-kilometer classic a week ago today. She won it by 43 seconds ahead of Marit Bjørgen, and today she starts only 32 seconds behind Marit Bjørgen. So yeah, anything can happen.
Marit Bjørgen just keeping herself on the move. Well, 4 minutes to go to the start of the concluding part of the Lillehammer Treble, and as you can see, the air temperature -1 and the snow temperature lurking around 0. Not easy for the servicemen, neither is the trail that lies ahead for the women.
These steep climbs, David, have a look at the climbs. The little one in the middle there, now the huge climb coming up towards the end of the 5-kilometer track, and they will go around this journey twice. And as you said, 0 degrees makes the grip wax for this, the classic race, even more difficult. And you need to get that right. Last weekend we saw in Finland, those who had the perfect grip, and the Finns got it so right, absolutely help them on their journey over this 10 kilometres.
Well, for the past 48 hours, the Norwegians, particularly Marit Bjørgen, also Teresa Johaug, have lavished praise, and quite rightly, on their service team for the quality skis they've been delivered. So it'll count for nothing if they get it wrong today. But I'm sure that the Norwegians have got so much experience, and this is home snow for them, that they should be absolutely on top of this. Just looking at the overall World Cup rankings, of course, you have at the moment a sort of false situation, but Marit Bjørgen, after four races, 276 ahead of Teresa Johaug, 178 points. And in fact, there are Norwegians occupying the first five places in the overall Wiesmann World Cup standings. So a couple of minutes to go. Sit back and enjoy the action here with Mike Dixon and myself, David Goldstrom. And the big question for the fans of Marit Bjørgen is, can she hold off Teresa Johaug? She's going to start with a 32-second advantage. And as Mike pointed out just a few minutes ago, last weekend she won by 43 seconds. So just mathematically, that wouldn't be enough. Between the two, Bjørgen and Johaug, it'll be Heidi Weng on the podium in the sprint, and absolutely delighted with her performance there. And then we've got Ragnhild Haga, interesting to see how she goes, before Ersberg and Charlotte Kalla, who surely should play a part in this, Mike.
I think so. She's so much improved, worked on her weakness, which was her classic style, and she now is a real competitor, third last weekend, over 10 kilometres in the classic. And Ersberg as well, anyone wearing red here, the Norwegian colours, have a good chance. They're very good. They're very high class in this style, and of course their skis will be running fast. The wax we'd expect is working well, the grip wax, that is.
So the winner of today's race, that applies to whoever has the fastest time gets 50 points and the prize money. There are no bonus seconds involved in this at all, mercifully. This is a straightforward pursuit race.
Well, that's right. The sprints 2 days ago and yesterday's, no bonus times yesterday either. It was just how well you did in the time trial yesterday, and all those times have added up to put them all on the grid today in this 3 day stage event.
It's 10:15 in the Berkey Beinen Stadium. Marit Bjørgen on the right of your picture wears the Wiesmann World Cup bib as the early leader of the World Cup cross-country season for women, and they're under starter's orders. And we didn't hear the gun, but it obviously went off there. And Marit Bjørgen, can she defend her lead of 20 seconds over Heidi Weng? Probably. Can she defend it over Teresa Johaug? 32 seconds the advantage? Maybe.
Well, Teresa Johaug will very quickly, I think, 12 seconds. She starts behind Weng, who's just set out on her race. I think Teresa Johaug, her strategy is going to be so clear. Attack and don't stop attacking. She'll quickly absorb, I think, Weng, and then they may work together. And there she goes.
Yeah, Heidi Weng in good form, though. I mean, two third-place finishes in the first and second races of this triple examination. And then you can see there's a little gaggle of them going out there. Ersberg wears five. And just to confuse us, four there, that's Haga, and they both decided to wear orange or pink headbands, so it doesn't make life any easier. Charlotte Kalla, of course, in white, and now a minute and 5 seconds, so Pamukoski and 15 over there, that's Chekalaiva of Russia, just getting underway, 16 on the right of your picture, Kerttu Niskanen for Finland, 17, Sadie Bjornsson for the United States, and on the far side, going away with Nicole Fessel, 22, that's Anastasia Dotsenko, right of screen, 24 away, Laura Mononen of Finland, and these women have a gap of a minute and 30 seconds back to Marit Bjørgen. And the first part of the course, Mike, for these athletes.
Well, this first part, you can see them, the double poling is faster when it's gently down to 120 meters flat, and then we start the first of the many climbs, the big climbs. There you are.
And the reality is, until they get back into the stadium, Mike, there isn't any other flat section. They're always either going up or coming down.
No flat whatsoever. And I think especially coming up to the 3.5 kilometers marker, you've got this 800 meters in distance, but almost 40 meters in terms of height gained over that climb. And in these conditions, around zero, it always makes the waxing, the grip waxing difficult. If anyone's struggling, we will see it on that major climb.
There you can see Heidi Beng pursuing and trying to move up quickly. And that 20-second gap there, you can see Teresa Juhags almost closed the 12 seconds that she had as a deficit to Heidi Beng.
David, at this level, to pull back 12 seconds in 2.5 minutes, that's a sprint in terms of what Juhags is doing right now. She'll probably rest up a little while behind Heidi Beng.
So that's the first 900 meters. Now we'll get a time check on Teresa Juhag. We're looking for less than 32 seconds. Charlotte Keller going up there has overtaken one or two. Denise Herrmann, tall figure, the German on the left there in the black and orange race suit. And here we come. It was 32 seconds to Juhag. And it's, well, 29 seconds, so, but it's 3 seconds nonetheless. Now, for Heidi Beng, she's got to try and do almost the impossible, which is to hang on to the ski tails of Juhag. Now, that may be a good thing. It may not be a good thing, because the tempo of Juhag, I think, for most people, would be disruptive.
Very difficult. When you're skiing in behind someone like that, you want to try and go stride for stride, but the incredible tempo that Juhag has, as you say, makes it very difficult, unsettling being behind her. But I think Heidi Beng's strategy was clear. She knew that Juhag was going to catch her, so she's just going to try and stick with her, try and stay with her pace.
And Kala, 55 seconds. Remember, she started 47 seconds back, so the pace of those three Norwegians up front, their intent has actually gained them a few seconds over Charlotte Keller and those who are chasing her. Ersberg also in that pack. Denise Herrmann, 49 seconds was her deficit when she set out. Chekalova, 126. And Chekalova was 113. So you can see that instant pace from Bjørgen and Juhag has had an immediate effect on the whole of the field.
It has, and well, Bjørgen's to be taking 10 seconds off already, and Ösberg, her strategy is clear. She wants to make it very difficult for Therese Juhag to feel some positive splits. That means that she's closing the time. And of course, she's been, Juhag has pulled by 3 seconds to this point. There we are, we can see down the track, that's the gap. Very difficult out front, David, with 100 athletes trying to chase you down. So a little tense there. We saw Marit Bjørgen's facial expressions. The officials were clearly telling her, well, you're out front, you need to know, confirm that you know exactly where you're going, because it's two laps around this 5 kilometer track.
And another illustration, Ida Ingsma Dotter, who went through the first 900 meters in ninth place, a minute and 11, and she started with a deficit of 57 seconds. So that's 14 seconds that those Norwegians, those upfront Norwegians, have taken out of the talented Swede.
Phenomenal pace that Bjørgen has set. She knows she has to win this one. She has to keep strong and keep that gap from Juhau, the terrier. Well, Heidi Beng, skis look like they're running a little better than Juhag. She's standing tall behind her.
Yes, and actually, this could be quite annoying for Teresa Juhag if Beng can hold on here. Heidi Beng might actually be doing Marit Bjørgen a little service here. 28 seconds. Now, that's only another second gain. So Marit Bjørgen, as they come round that loop there, so far so good, but there's still a long way to go. They've just gone through 2,200 meters, so approximately a quarter of the race.
And if you're watching yesterday, these corners look quite easy yesterday, same track as they were on yesterday, but today with it being classic, there's so much, very little support through the ankle. It's almost like a running shoe that you're wearing with a little bar at the front connected to your binding.
Now, Ersberg started with a 46-second deficit, and you can see that's 17 seconds she's leaked. Kalla, 103. Kalla started with 47 seconds. So again, that's 17 seconds she's leaked. So the pace up front there, Marit Bjørgen has put her foot straight down on the accelerator right from the beginning.
She had no option, I think. And, you know, when she when you look at the start sheet, you see Therese Johaug 32 seconds behind. You know you don't want to give her any hope. And Marit's had to go for this really seriously attacking strategy. She doesn't like doing that. She likes to start gently and open up her pace. But clearly, when you've got Johaug chasing you down, you've got to adapt your strategy. And she's done just that.
Kowalczyk, 137. And she started 132 off, so she's virtually running at the same speed as the Norwegians up front, but she hasn't made a real difference as yet. Now Marit double polling, fantastic strength here, and Mike, this is what she does so well, doesn't she? This is where in a way she's better than Johaug.
Very much. She's just got so much upper body strength. She's renowned for her strength in the gym and the pull-up she can do, the dips that she can do. But this is textbook, the best technique you'll see. So video this, copy this if you're learning how to be the best you can be in classic technique. She pulls the hands closer to her shoulders, David, to make sure that she's more upright, keeping the hips forward. This is a very steep climb. We're looking at a 21% climb here, or 21 degree climb. And she's trying to slide the ski through and forward from the hip. You can see the ski slipping.
And as we see, Marit Bjørgen, I just want to appetize those of you perhaps up in the Huntley Ski Club. Remember, we've got the men's 15-kilometer classic pursuit with Andrew Musgrave wearing bib number 10, starting at 12 o'clock Central European time, an hour earlier for those of you with us on British Eurosport. A personal best yesterday when he finished 13th, better than any other British Nordic skier in history. And because of one or two defections, he's going to start with bib 10 today, and he's only 59 seconds behind Finn Krogh. And actually, he's only 30 seconds behind Martin Jonsrud Sundby, the World Cup champion of last season. So something to look forward to. And now we get another time check here. 3.3 kilometers, approximately one third of the distance. So Marit Bjørgen coming up to that point at the moment.
David, this is the changes. Well, we're back on Bjørgen. We were on Johaug. Johaug, her classic technique has always been good, but it's the coaches have realized from a young age she wasn't the most efficient. And this year, Johaug in the background has worked so much on trying to get benefit. As we're seeing from Bjørgen here, you compress the ski and then glide. That's the efficiency in this technique, the glide factor.
Now, they were 28, 29 seconds. This is where Johaug can really make a difference now. She just dances up these hills.
Love it. See the compression, the head's bobbing a little. That's getting the body drop, the explosiveness through the ski.
So it was 28.29, so they've nibbled another 4 to 5 seconds away. And all credit to Heidi Weng. Skis, I agree with you, Mike. Looks as if Heidi Weng's got a really good pair of skis.
She has, and I love her strategy. She knew that Johaug was going to haul her in quickly. And then she's just going to try and take the pain here, stay with his incredible pace. And then she'll try and pass her out, imagine, in the last 500 metres, if she can stay with the pace.
It's a fantastic mental and physical test for Heidi Weng. She's in good form, two podiums already this weekend. And here comes Charlotte Kalla. Now, Charlotte Kalla, 1:03, so 63 seconds behind at 2.2 kilometres. And she's being pursued there by Ersberg, who's a tough cookie. And 1:10, so they've leaked another 7 seconds. And it's all because Marit Bjørgen is just turning the screw, because she has to, because Johaug is eating into her lead. But is Johaug eating into her lead sufficiently?
To pull 8 seconds back up to the 3.3 kilometres, so 8:16:24, I think that the journey is going well for Johaug, but look at the facial expression. She's on her absolute limit.
One or two further back, Denise Herman in sixth place. Ragnhild Haga, haven't really talked about her, but I was really impressed with her performance yesterday. And when she finished in that fifth position, that's a really good performance by her. It was a personal best. And she's just 23 years of age. And again, another great junior talent, a junior world bronze medalist and a 5 kilometer freestyle gold medalist. So the distance is fine and she's an achiever. She's also a 10 kilometer world under 23 champion. So, you know, she's just waiting in the wings for her turn.
Yeah, incredible strength and depth, this Norwegian team. Tough team to make for the world championships, really, if you're wearing the Norwegian suit.
Marit Bjørgen approaching the half distance. Teresa gulping in the oxygen here. The course is quite twisty, Mike, so from time to time they lose visual contact. They're going to get a reality check here. Likewise, Marit's going to get a reality check as to where the other two are, because as she goes round, the others will be coming in. So remember the last time, Johaug down at 24 seconds with Heidi Weng. And I suspect they've reduced that a little bit, but remember, still half the race to go. So what's happening here is Juhal knows the pacing. She's getting some guidance from the coaches. And what she's trying to do is to reel this in as economically as she can.
She is. And 24 seconds, it's not closed, David, since 3.3. So Marit Bjørgen. But for me, Marit, you can just see her in the distance there. She looked a little panicked because she did look over her shoulder coming up that 3.3 hill and realizing that, well, Teresa's not far behind at all.
But actually, when you consider that, it was on that hill yesterday that she lost her 4 second cushion of time. So to have actually held them on this rotation is good work. Whether she can hold them on the second time around, that's going to be the real test. And now Charlotte Keller has broken away with Ersberg from the rest. These are the women in fourth and fifth places. Ersberg, you can see physically so much bigger than Callow, almost towering her, but again, good skis running in behind. So we've got a group of two and then three behind, and the gap now has stretched again, 1:23. Last time we looked, it was 1:10, so that's a big loss of time for those two.
It is, and we can say with certainty that without a doubt Kala's not going to make contact to fight for the positions 1, 2 or 3 unless Heidi Weng, Therese has a complete blowout, but certainly wouldn't expect that over the next 5 kilometers.
I think Weng is mentally in such good shape, having got the two podiums. She wants 3 podiums out of the weekend. So there'll be that sort of desire that you get inside you. She'll have woken up this morning and said, I've had such a good Friday, a really good Saturday. Can I have, you know, as good a Sunday?
She's highly motivated. The Norwegian team are the most motivated. They're 7 in the top 11, I think you said earlier. They're destroying the rest of the field, and because of this lady here who's lifted the levels over her last 10, 11, 12 years, or 87 wins, could be 88 today.
You know, Marit Bjørgen is 11 years older than Heidi Weng. But Heidi Weng, you know, perhaps we're not giving her as much credit as we should do, because, you know, when she got those third place finishes this weekend, that was matching up her third place in the 50-kilometer Tour de Ski effort and the 30 kilometers in Falun last year. So she is a really improving athlete, as you see the stats there. The first three have got a decisive break over the rest. So, well, we talked about her on the flat. How much worse is she, if I can put it that way, than Teresa Johaug? Because she isn't bad. She is a good climber.
She is a very good climber. I think when it comes to climbing, we mentioned it the other day in the sprint races and yesterday in the 5 kilometer, Therese Johaug has the little disadvantage with her very, very light body weight when it comes to extreme hill climbing. And so Therese Johaug pulls back 1.5, 2 seconds maybe on of course Bjørgen on the big climbs.
I just detected though that the Bjørgen's tempo was not as strong. And you can see they've taken 3 seconds out in 900 meters. Well, actually 2 seconds in 900 meters out of Bjergen. So the tempo up that first 900 meters from Bjergen was not as good as it needed to be. And I think she's going to get a sharp reminder from the coaches as she moves up in the next kilometer, because the next kilometer for her is crucial. She can't afford to give time away. It's 2.2 to 3.3. And for Marit Bjergen, she needs, well, if she could have 20 seconds, I fear that it might be more like 15 or 14 seconds when she gets to 3.3. And then it's a question of whether Teresa Johaug can make maybe 12 to 15 seconds in the last 1,700 metres of the race. That's going to be the big question.
That is the big question. And it was interesting there. They pulled back on a relatively simple part of the track, pulled back that further two seconds. Marit is probably looking at, well, 6 kilometres, more than six done now, that she just needs to keep that 20-second cushion.
And two have become five again here, because that's also Ragnhild Haga, who's in there, eight. That is just checking on that. Kalla Herman Faller in there, Micah Kaspersen Faller. And Marit Bjergen now.
Look at this climb, David. And Marit did see the bang and Johaug coming around or down the bend. And she certainly is a little more tense now, realizing she has to keep this punishing pace going.
Right. Mike, what happens if Johaug actually gets to her?
Then Johaug would rest up, try and get some recovery in behind her, but I don't think Marit's going to allow that to happen.
But or would Marit just say, OK, you want to sprint? Do you want to sprint in the stadium? Do you want to sprint down the final 100?
Yes, and the double polling power, you'd expect Marit would match her and beat her in the sprint finish, but we are running out of track here, so Marit's got to be beginning to be feeling a little more positive. She went so fast at the beginning that she is suffering now, but so is Therese Johaug.
So this is now really getting fascinating. Marit through. There she gets the visual. Now that will actually give us some heart.
I think it will, to realise the gap is going. But look at the tempo from Therese Johaug. Marit Bjergen knows full well the aggressiveness, the attacking nature of Johaug, and she cannot allow herself to let Johaug close it down much more than 15 seconds.
So it's dropped from 21.9 to 18. But now, Mike, from 2.2 to 3.3, this is the really demanding climb. So if they gained, what did they gain? They gained 4 seconds. They could gain 6 seconds on Marit Bjergen on this kilometre. And if they do that, then the gap will be down to 12. And then it's a question, is 12 seconds a big enough cushion for Marit Bjergen to hold them off in the last 1,700 metres?
It's on the limit, I think it's on the limit. And when we saw Marit going up that last climb, you could see her slipping, so she's trying to compress the wax onto the snow to get the grip to push you up the hill, but her skis were slipping. Quite likely a lot of the athletes are, because the tracks are now even more icy than at the beginning of the race.
What Marit has hopefully got is a coach at the top of the 3.3 climb who gives her an exact time differential advantage, and that will be radioed up, and so that would give her the confidence boost. They'll say, you've got 12, you've got 10 seconds, that's what you've got, Marit.
And I think Marit will just be on survival when she realises at the top of the major climb with 1.7 to go, that really is a race in the bag if she's still got a 15-second cushion there.
Kalla, 1.39 back. They've steadied it a little bit, and that just indicates also that the pace has steadied off the front, because it's related to Marit Bjergen. So they've only lost, between 900 and 2,200, they've only lost another 3 seconds. So the indication is to Bjergen slowing.
It appears that way. Kowalczyk there from bib 30, she started, David. She's moved up to ninth position now, and she's got this little gaggle, this little pack ahead of her to pull back another number of places for the money, for the World Cup points.
Now this is where Marit Bjørgen can be a lot more positive on that section there, the stride and glide after the double poling. But now Teresa Johan still trying to get away, and she's still got Heidi Weng breathing on her neck. And I think this is fascinating, because I think Heidi Weng so far has done a really good service. Now, Johan, you can see there, 11.5 kilometers. She's a couple of kilometers quicker than Bjørgen, and this was always going to be the crucial kilometer.
Well, this is down to 15, maybe even less than 15 seconds, David. It's quite an amazing achievement there from Johaug to be trying to pull back 32 seconds on Bjørgen. Two different styles. Bjørgen has got the strength. She's reaching a long way with each glide. As usual, Johaug, it's short, it's sharp, it's aggressive.
What do you make of Heidi Weng? Because Heidi Weng is on paper. She can cling on here. She's arguably the better sprinter, but she is now under pressure. You can just see the shoulders just moving a little horizontally, and Johaug's gone now. Johaug knows that she has to commit from this point on, and Johaug is also concerned because she knows that if Marit Bjørgen can hold on to the top of the climb, then, Marit Bjørgen suddenly may get the edge again.
Marit's going to be thinking another strategy, David. She's thinking, can't believe Johaug is closing it down, but she may well just be conserving herself if she gets absorbed for that final 200 sprint.
They're both getting the odd slip here, and it'd be interesting to see the time difference, because I think the time differential has just balanced itself there. Johaug not quite as fast. Here comes Marit Bjørgen. This is the 8.3 kilometer point up here. Oh, this is painful. Both of them will be hurting a great deal.
You can see Marit slipping there, and the tempo's gone right down. Every time she's trying to compress, she's slipping, so she's having to shorten the stride a little. But Teresa's got her. By the top of this hill, I would say they'll be together.
Well, they're going through now, 5.3 seconds. You know, I was talking about 12. Now it's a question of what Marit can do on these downhill sections. Because there's Johaug chasing.
And Johaug knows 100 million percent that she needs to be on the tail of her skis by the top of this rise. And you know, David, I think she's going to do it. Oh, what a race. And Johaug looking to it over her left shoulder, realizing that the pace has destroyed Heidi Weng as well.
Yeah, it's just this little bit of undulation here. And Teresa Johaug within a couple of meters now.
Well, that was the most amazing pace up the steep climb from Johaug.
I think Johaug's got to go past Bjørgen and not leave it to a final sprint.
It would be her advantage, David, I think, to slot in behind, but you're right, she's going to go straight past.
A little bit of herringbone there for a moment from Marit Bjørgen. And now Johaug trying to come up on her shoulder. Oh. And Johaug now goes past Bjørgen, does she?
Well, Bjørgen has to try and limit the damage, because she needs to stick with Johaug if Johaug does get past.
This is really hard, and Bjørgen there, just a little wobble again, and Johaug getting the advantage, and Bjørgen deciding, right, this is the right way to go. Go in the track. She's got the better track, Johaug, and Bjørgen's going to stick on her ski tails. This is where Bjørgen has got a stick on her ski tails, and now we'll know how well the servicemen have done their job.
Oh, Marit was exhausted going around that corner. Normally she tucks a little lower, but I think now it's survival for Marit, clearly, to hang on behind. And she is the best, slightly better downhiller, is Marit Bjørgen.
12 seconds now. I think Heidi Weng's still pretty secure, because look at the gap there. It's 1:35 back to the chasing pack led by Charlotte Keller.
Well, Therese Johaug, she had two weaknesses, the sprinting and the classic technique. She's worked on both of them, improved massively, and I think she's untouchable again this season.
Well, she is the defending World Cup champion. And look at these gaps going back there. Kowalczyk, 2:11. It just shows you what the Norwegians have really punished themselves up front. But this is Marit Bjørgen and Teresa Johaug.
I think Therese, yes, when she caught up with Johaug, it was an advantage to try and get a 3-4 second gap at the top of the climb.
And you can't tell anything between the skis there. They look as if they've both got excellent skis. Marit Bjørgen closing a little bit there. Marit Bjørgen, though, is the proven sprinter out of these two.
She is, and Marit Bjørgen knows this final climb, she has to stay with Johaug to have a chance to win this one.
She's had a bit of a recovery opportunity. Remember, she's into the sort of sprint distance that she's used to. And now the double poling there from Marit. That worked.
And Marit was clipping the tails of Johaug skis. That irritates the athlete ahead, but she's not doing it deliberately. Look at this. And she's trying to, Marit's trying to go stride for stride to stay right in behind.
Yeah, and it is annoying, Teresa. It is definitely annoying, Teresa Johaug, that Marit Bjerg is there. But it's actually reminding Teresa Johaug that Marit is still there. So again, another little bit of undulation that they've got to negotiate here, which favours Teresa.
And Marit knows she's got to get in the slipstream so that she can slingshot herself like this into the stadium.
And here they go. She's got the inside line, Marit, there, and takes the lead ahead of Teresa Johaug. Rides the skis over the roller coaster. Now she's got that ski length advantage. But here, from here, she's committed. It's the 100 metres on the left. It's Teresa Johaug. On the right there, it's Marit Bjergen. The sprint is on. And Teresa Johaug pulling it out here. Marit Bjergen will not be denied. Look at the double polling. Enormous strength. Fantastic Bjergen. And she's turned it around.
Well, what a race.
300s yesterday to Johaug, 600s today to Bjergen. And could you wish for a better race? And Heidi Weng, a super third. That's three podium finishes in a row for her, and another podium for the Norwegians. A clean sweep.
Do you know what? The experience, the wisdom, the race line, the strategy, Marit got it right in the last 200 metres there. I was a little surprised she went past her early, but you needed to be around that bottom corner into the home straight in first position.
It was taking the inside line on that right-hander to give her the lead. That was the slingshot that gave her the momentum.
What a race.
And 100 metres, Marit Bjergen, the double polling was exquisite.
Well, we did say earlier she's got the most phenomenal upper body strength. The stomach is so rock solid strong, and an almost impossible athlete to beat in the final 150 flat.
Yeah, you're really talking core strength, aren't you? Oh,
big time, big time. But this climb, I was impressed with Bjergen adjusting, adapting her stride length to that of Johaug, which is not easy because Johaug is the tempo that nobody can match.
So have a look at what's happened here, because this is bib number five, and it's Ersberg who's broken away from Charlotte Kaller, and it's a 1-2-3-4 for Norway. And again, this isn't podium, but this is Ersberg underlining the progress that she's made this season. What a Norwegian women's team. If they race like this in Falun, they will be irresistible.
Can they keep this form going? Well, if it was any other team, you'd be asking the questions, can they? But I think the Norwegians can.
And they're not finished. Kalla, 150. And then after that, Haga, that's a decent position as well for her. And look at this, Falla as well. So, what is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That is 6 out of the top 7 are Norwegian. Well, it was always going to be about those two, but just looking at some of the other finishes there, Kalla the best for Sweden. Pamukoski, another decent race from the Finn there, Krista Pamukoski in eighth place. Now, Pamukoski, she started with a deficit of, just checking on this, what was her deficit, Pamukoski? She had a deficit of 106 and 213. Kurtu Niskanen also skied well. Justina Kowalczyk up to 10th place from 30th. So next up, it's the men in action, and Martin Fourcade. The men's pursuit from Östersund, and Patrick Winterden, your host for that competition. But I wonder whether the men biathletes over in Östersund can live up to that performance of Marit Bjergen and Teresa Johaug. It may have been a two-horse race, but what a race, Mike.
It was quite unbelievable that Therese Johaug pulled the 32 seconds back. It looked impossible. She did the impossible, but couldn't quite match Bjørgen on the finish.
We'll be back at 11 o'clock for Andrew Musgrave, who will wear bib 10 in the men's 15-kilometre pursuit finale.